So, yeah. So we will be recording the speaker's talk. And so welcome to our seminar, virtual seminar, ISPP virtual seminar. My name is Yingyi Hong, and I'm the host and moderator of today's talk. And today we are very happy to have Ku Yang Chong, who is now a PhD candidate at Clark University, to talk to us about one of his projects. And I just learned that actually he's attending a conference now. So we are so glad to have him. He is now at his location. It's about 9 p.m. So we are especially thankful that he spent a conference evening with us. And so without much ado, let me give the floor to Ku Yang. Yeah, please take it away.
Thank you so much, Dr. Hong, for your very kind introduction. I'll share my screen now. Okay. Can you see my PowerPoint?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. So as Dr. Hong just said, I'm Ku Yang Zhang, and I'm a PhD candidate at Clark University in the United States. My research focuses on many different things, but among them is collective victim beliefs. And today I'm gonna share my works that I conducted in my home country, South Korea, and especially about the complexity of collective victim beliefs in South Korea. And I'm very honored to share my works here at ISPP Asian Pacific region. And let's start. So in the aftermath of collective violence, members of victimized groups subjectively interpret and draw meanings from their experiences of victimization. This control is called collective victim beliefs. And as you can easily imagine, such subjective understandings of collective victimization can be diverse and multifaceted depending on the history, politics, and social climate in the given context. In South Korea, the memories of Japanese colonization of the Korean Peninsula are still very salient. And social representation of history, including collective memories of violence such as colonization, plays a crucial role in forming the group's identity and guiding interactions with other groups. When we look at the modern relationship between South Korea and Japan, it is full of hostility and distrust. This negative relationship is a consequence of Japanese colonization of Korean Peninsula and war crimes committed during the Pacific War. And these atrocities include exploitation, forced labor, massacre, and operation of sexual slavery, which is operated by the Imperial Japanese Army during the war. Thus, we decided to conduct a series of studies to gain deeper understanding on Korean people's collective victim beliefs and their implications for intergroup relations. In the literature of collective victim beliefs, comparative victim beliefs have gained the most attention. Collective victimhood is often conceptualized as a psychological resource that groups compare, compete over, and share with other groups. This emphasis on comparative aspect of collective victim beliefs may be due to the fact that most research on collective victim beliefs so far has primarily focused on the context of intractable conflicts, such as Israeli-Palestinian conflict or the trouble in Northern Ireland. However, distinct collective victim beliefs may be salient in different contexts, for example, South Korea. In addition, we can expect a diverse set of narratives regarding collective victimhood within the same society. So there will be an intra-group diversity of collective victim beliefs. People may perceive in-group victimization in many different ways, and such distinct collective victim beliefs may be relevant to different intergroup strategies. So this raises the first question, which collective victim beliefs can we identify among South Koreans? To answer this question, we conducted an exploratory qualitative research. So we aim to explore the complex nature of diverse range of collective victim beliefs in Korean society. And we conducted a thematic analysis on media discourse in South Korea. We chose 72 newspaper articles from South Korea, and we qualitatively analyzed them. And victim narratives and other social representation of history are shared through societal channels, including media, and newspaper is one of the most prominent platform for diffusing such narratives and representation. So we conducted, as I just said, we conducted a systematic analysis on media discourse from six newspapers, three from the right-wing newspapers. On your left, you see 조선일보, 중앙일보, and 동아일보. They are typically considered as very conservative platforms. And on your right, there are 한겨레, 경향신문, and Omainews, which are very left-leaning newspapers. We collected data from those two platforms to take the political orientations into account. So we sampled articles from three time frames published on those six newspapers. And those time frames were during which those time frames are characterized by the debates about three key events concerning Japanese colonizations. And the time frames in which those debate was particularly intense. The first one was from December 26, 2015 to January 1st, 2016. And this was around the Japan-South Korea, the signing of the Japan-South Korea Comfort Women Agreement. This Comfort Women refers to young women who are abducted and forced by the Imperial Japanese Army to serve as sex slaves. And this agreement between the two governments were controversial. Some Koreans perceived it as an exoneration of Japanese war crimes, while others considered it diplomatically necessary. The second time frame was after the registration of Hashima Island or Battleship Island, which is just outside Nagasaki, Japan. The UNESCO decided to register this island, this artificial island, as a World Heritage. And this decision by UNESCO caused a huge outrage in Korea because of the forced labors at this floating industry complex caused multiple hundreds of deaths of Korean laborers who were also abducted by Japanese Imperial Army and Japanese government at the time. And the third time frame is before and after of Korean National Liberation Day in 2017. Which is this day is commemorated as the day Japan surrendered to the Allied powers and Korea was liberated from the Japanese colonial rule. And we chose these events as particularly relevant because colonial violence such as sexual slavery, forced labor, and Korea's liberation are crucial for understanding Korea's collective memories and attitudes towards Japan. Additionally, public debates around policies related to collective violence provide a rich data for understanding collective narratives. So this is the result of our thematic analysis. We identify three main categories, which are here. And each category contains multiple themes. As we don't have much time, I'm just gonna summarize the findings. So first category is transmission of memories of victimization, and this category and collective victim beliefs belonging to these categories keeps the history and memories of Korean victimization salient and relevant to the present and future generations. Many newspaper articles discuss the importance of commemoration, educating younger generation about the in-group victimization, concerns for loss of memories and survivors due to the passage of time, and mindset of never again vis-a-vis the prevention of the repetition of the violence and victimization. I will give you some time to read the quote here, which is from one of the articles we analyzed. And many articles also cover the challenges of victimizations and its aftermath, which were coded as category two. Such narratives describe the hardship and grievances that linger in Korean society in the aftermath of Japanese colonization. At the same time, there were a lot of discussion of various coping efforts to counter such challenge, which was coded as category three. As those two categories are closely related, I will just present them side by side. So some of the challenges and grievances mentioned in the articles included a sense of in-group vulnerability that arises from past and ongoing struggles of colonization, colonialism, and in-group fragmentation due to the contested narratives over history and disagreement on how to preserve memories or address modern Japan-South Korea relations. So here you can see this quote. This is quote by Cho Sun-ilbo, which depicts an event where a young girl, a teenage girl, was abducted by the Japanese soldiers, and she was forced to serve as a sexual slavery in Taiwan. And this sense of vulnerability was countered by various in-group empowerment efforts, such as commemoration and celebration of resistance movements during the colonization period, and strengthening in-group solidarity. And as you can see here, the former president of South Korea, Moon Jae-in, declared that he and his government will support the survivors of colonialism and their descendants financially. And next, there were discussions of collective victim bliss regarding Japanese denial of their violence committed against Koreans. And Koreans' collective effort to demand perpetrators' acknowledgement and justice, which is arguably the defining issue of modern Japan-South Korea relationship. I will give you some time to read the quotes. Finally, there were narratives associated with intergroup relations. Namely, there was a discussion of how the relationship between Japan and South Korea is strained by historical issues. And at the same time, some articles also emphasize the need and potential for more positive relationship with Japan. And here, this article from Hangyore described the problem of the compensation for the forced labor victims as the time bomb that could shape Japan-Korea relations. But at the same time, this article from Dong-a-ilbo cited the former Foreign Ministry of Foreign Affairs, who said that Japan and Korea can benefit more from forming a positive relationship. So this finding illustrates the importance of considering a greater complexity of collective victim beliefs. Existing literature on collective victim beliefs focus on intractable conflicts and limited ways in which people make sense of their in-group victimization, such as comparative victim beliefs. Interestingly, our findings show that comparative victim beliefs were hardly mentioned in media narratives in South Korea. So this suggests that different collective victim beliefs are relevant in different contexts. And also the finding illustrates the importance of considering underrepresented contexts such as post-colonial nations in Asia. And this is also true for other contexts such as Africa, Latin America, and many other places on Earth. And finally, our finding illustrates the different historical and current contexts of collective victimization and its aftermath. And finally, the structure of collective victim beliefs we identify roughly correspond to the process outlined in the appraisal approach to group victimization coined by Colin Leach. According to this theoretical framework, there are primary and secondary appraisal process. In the primary appraisal stage, people assess whether the in-group victimization is relevant to their group's current goals or values. In the second appraisal stage, people interpret the collective victimization event to give meaning to it. which invokes various emotions. In turn, the coping potential is assessed and specific coping efforts such as resistance or collective actions demanding reparations are chosen accordingly. And our findings show that people actively engage in diverse appraisal processes and take multiple actions, multiple forms of actions to counter the challenges of grievances resulting from the history of victimization. And then the remaining question is, what are the implications of such diverse victim beliefs, especially on the intergroup relations and people's policy preferences, how they manifest in people's preferences for different policies addressing intergroup relations? Thus, in the next study, we investigated the relationship between diverse collective victim beliefs and different strategies to address the issues of Japan-South Korea relationship. Based on the previous quality study, we developed survey items to measure various collective victim beliefs. We then conducted a pilot study and tested which collective victim beliefs formed reliable scales. EFA revealed four collective victim beliefs measures. The first one is preserving memories of historical victimization and supporting survivors, which had six items. The second one is grievances concerning historical victimization and perpetrator denial in the present. Third one is in-group fragmentation concerning how to address historical victimization. And the fourth one is the perceived prevalence of in-group resistance against denial. We hypothesized that these distinct forms of collective victim beliefs will have effect on South Koreans' preferences for different policies or different intergroup outcomes. For the main survey, we collected 249 South Koreans through snowball sampling. And for the intergroup outcome variables, for the outcome variable, we measured willingness to participate in collective action, demanding apology and reparation from the Japanese, willingness for reconciliation, desire for retribution, and the feeling of resentment. We then hypothesized the effect of each collective victim belief scale on the distinct intergroup strategies. First, we hypothesized that the preserving memories and supporting survivors would positively predict collective action. And because social psychological model of collective action take the group's grievances as a starting point for the processes that lead to collective action. In the context of historical victimization, the in-group's grievances can involve not just collective memories of victimization, past suffering, but also the perpetrator group's present-day denial of responsibility. Denial is often considered as a continuation of the in-group's victimization and as a severe injustice causing anger and resentment. Second, we predict the grievance would positively predict collective action. Secondly, we also hypothesized that the preserving memories of historical victimization and supporting in-group will, I mixed that up, sorry about that. So I just talked about the grievances predicting collective action. Now I'm gonna talk about preserving memories predicting collective action. We predicted that preserving memories and historical victimization and supporting survivors would predict collective actions because the degree to which people believe that it is important to preserve memories of victimization and support survivors indicates whether they appraise the history of injustice as relevant today. This isn't necessary for group members to engage in coping strategies such as collective action. Also, the salience of historical victimhood increases the victim members' tendency to act on behalf of their in-group. Third, we predicted that perceived prevalence of resistance would positively predict collective action. Group members are more likely to support or engage in collective action when they believe that the in-group has the necessary resources to achieve the desired outcome. And knowing others are willing to participate in collective action is one of those resources called instrumental social support. So perceiving that the in-group is actively protesting against the perpetrator group should increase the members' perceived social support. And finally, we hypothesize that the in-group fragmentation would negatively predict collective action. And this was because believing that the in-group is divided on how to deal with the grievances may indicate lacking social support and social resources and cohesion, and that their group is divided. We also hypothesized that grievance would negatively predict reconciliation, and this is because the existing literature suggests that perpetrator groups' denial of the in-group historical victimization reduces willingness to reconcile. And finally, we predicted that both preserving memories and perceived grievances would predict more desire for retribution, because the previous findings suggest that lack of apology from the perpetrators lead to greater desire for retribution and decreased forgiveness. Also, collective victim beliefs concerning the importance of remembering the in-group victimization may legitimize hostility towards the historical perpetrator group, in this case, Japan. We also have hypothesized a mediating role of resentment, which is also one of many understudied forms of emotion. The appraisal approach to collective victimization that I mentioned earlier poses that the role of emotion is crucial. In the context of dealing with the historical colonization and war crimes, resentment, which is an emotional reaction to the sense of injustice and humiliation, is highly relevant. Both reminders of past victimization and the perpetrator's denial may increase victims' resentment of those responsible for the violence. As resentment is often a driving force of social movements, it should predict increased interest in collective action. Additionally, resentment may justify the in-group's hostile vengeful actions. Thus, resentment should predict increased desire for retribution and less support for reconciliation. So this is a result. There were some unexpected effects as well. Some of the hypotheses were supported and some were not. And this is, we conducted structural equation modeling to test our hypothesis. And this is a final model that was yielded by the analysis. The fit indices indicated that this model has a very good, not very good, but adequate to acceptable fit indices. And as you can see, the path is quite complex. So I will just break this down into different parts. First, let's look at the effect of memories and support. So as expected, preserving memories and supporting survivors predicted collective actions, more willingness to participate in collective action. And the effect on the resentment here was marginally significant with a p-value of 0.058. However, memories and support did not predict retribution. Next, grievance concerning historical victimization and perpetrator denial predicted more willingness to participate in collective action, less willingness to reconcile with the Japanese, and more resentment, but did not predict desire for retribution. As opposed to our hypothesis, in-group fragmentation did not predict collective action, but surprisingly predicted a willingness to reconcile. Perceived resistance also failed to predict collective action, but there was an unexpected effect here as well, in which perceived prevalence of resistance predicted more willingness to reconcile with Japan. These are very counterintuitive results. This may be due to the unusual time frame during which the data was collected. The data was collected 2 years ago, and as there was a nationwide, and 2 years ago when there was a trade war, ongoing trade war between Japan and South Korea. And as there was a nationwide protest and division in opinion at the time, such confusion may be reflected in our results. This may also explain the null effects of collective action. The widespread indignation might have overridden any effects on collective action because collective movements at the time were already pretty prevalent and widespread in Korea. Next, feeling of resentment predicted collective action, but not reconciliation. It predicted retribution. Finally, we will look at the indirect effects. So the indirect effect of preserving memories and supporting survivors on collective action through resentment was marginally significant. And the indirect effect of grievances on collective action via resentment was significant. Finally, the indirect effect of preserving memories and supporting survivors on retribution through resentment was marginally significant. And the indirect effect of grievances on collective action via resentment was significant. Yep, so this is our final model. So our results show diverse concept of collective victim beliefs among regular South Koreans, and as the findings from same with the findings from the first study, the current quantitative findings illustrate the importance of considering greater complexity of collective victim beliefs. Our findings also reveal the mobilizing effects of different collective victim beliefs for distinct integral strategies. Also, the findings illustrate the importance of considering emotions such as resentment as a process variable. So far, we have looked at the complexity and diversity of collective victim beliefs in South Korea. And this final study I'm going to present is about how such diverse collective victim beliefs are structured within society and form meaningful narratives. The third study aimed to achieve two goals. First, to explore the heterogeneity in how people's South Koreans, in this case, understand their ingress experience of victimization. We are also especially interested in how different collective victim beliefs form a coherent narrative structures or viewpoints. Secondly, we aim to investigate the effect of different structures of collective victim beliefs on Japan-South Korea relations. To achieve this goal, we conducted a Q methodology investigation, which is a small N method, small sample method that systematically and holistically examines people's viewpoints. And Q methodology captures difference within and between groups provides an overarching picture of collective perspectives or narratives. And these narratives or viewpoints represent the different stances on certain issues that are present within group. To conduct a Q study, we first needed to develop statements or items. We first compiled empirical research articles on site info using search keywords such as collective victimhood or historical trauma. We found 121 articles in social, political, community, and counseling psychology, but many of them were dropped because they only briefly touched the topic of collective victimhood or their measure was not, you know, defined properly or measured properly. We extracted various collective victim belief constructs from those selected articles and created 60 items that would be used in our Q study. So the study was a part of a larger project that involved multiple groups in multiple countries. For this presentation, I will only focus on a study done with the community sample of 50 South Koreans. The research was done online via Zoom or Skype early 2021. We measured demographic variables, and at the end of each session, we asked an open-ended question to the participants regarding how to deal with the contemporary Japan-South Korea relations. We recorded and transcribed the participant responses and analyzed them later, which I will share soon. Before see our results, I will briefly explain what a Q study session would look like. We used online software to administer each trial, and the program will show participants 60 cards that have 60 statements we created based on literature review. The participants were instructed to read each question and first do a pre-sorting. They read the cards and roughly sorted them into three piles. The ones they agreed to by clicking thumbs up, the ones they feel neutral or not so sure about by clicking the question mark in a circle, and the ones they do not agree. So down the voting button by clicking the down voting button. After that, participants further sorted the cards in a more specific manner. They sorted the cards on a normal distribution figure that has a bipolar scale of -6 to +6, -6 being the most disagree and the +6 being the most agree. And participants drag and drop each card on scale slash figure according to how much they agree or disagree to each statement. Now the analysis. So the analysis of QSORT data involves the calculation of correlations and a factor analysis across participants' holistic QSORTs of all items, rather than individual items that only reflect isolated opinions, because we are interested in a holistic viewpoint. It is similar to a regular factor analysis, but in a Q study, factors are comprised of individual participant and perspectives instead of items. And their QSORTs form shared perspectives that are reflected on each factor or viewpoint. We conducted several rounds of factor analysis, extracting different numbers of factors using various rotation methods. We found that a two-factor solution is extracted by principal component analysis with Barry-Max rotation. And that we thought that was the optimal solution to our data. 15 participants were excluded from the solution because of the crossroadings. And here are the participant characteristics of the two factors. There were no notable differences in terms of gender composition and mean age, but there was a significant difference in terms of political orientations. So participants in viewpoint two are politically more moderate than their counterparts in viewpoint one. So the political orientation were measured on a 7-point scale, 1 being very liberal, 7 being very conservative, and 4 being moderate. As you can see here, the mean value of political orientation of factor 2 was exactly 4. And participants in viewpoint 1, on the other hand, were more likely to identify themselves as leftists. So now let's see the results. The first factor was perspective that emphasized preserving memories of victimization, in-group strengthening, and demand for justice. Here you see the number of each statement, and at the end of each statement, there's Z-scores, which are basically standard deviations from the grad mean. So the positive Z-scores indicate general agreement to the statement, and the negative value indicates disagreement. The boldest statements are what we called distinguishing statements, which are items that are statistically significantly different compared to the Z-scores of their counterparts in the other factor or viewpoint. As you can see, there is a strong endorsement of preserving, protecting, and transmitting the memories of Korean victimization. And participants in this viewpoint generally rejected the notion that the history of suffering is not relevant or not central to them. Okay, and this perspective or viewpoint is also characterized by a strong tendency to strengthen the in-group by supporting the victims and survivors who suffer the colonial violence firsthand. And protecting and preserving cultural identity was also part of it. Enhancing group cohesion, supporting Korean companies and businesses instead of Japanese ones. And the participant also rejected the notion of loss of Korean community. And relatedly, there were some collective victim beliefs about the Korean people's will to resist oppression and rejection of the lack of power or a sense of control. And then there was a narrative about the lack of justice and acknowledgement from the Japanese side and the Korean people's entitlement to reparation and compensation. In a nutshell, the first factor is characterized by a strong focus on transmission and preservation of memories of in-group victimhood and in conjunction with the perceived personal relevance to the in-group victimhood. This is consistent with the previous findings I presented today, and which also suggests that the transmission and preservation of memories is one of the most prominent agendas in Korea. Viewpoint one also emphasizes the in-group power, cohesion, and community, and this is consistent with existing literature suggesting that the salience of historic in-group victimhood may lead to various in-group strengthening behaviors, such as defending their cultural identity or helping in-group members in need. Considering the perceived importance and salience of victimhood memories in this factor or viewpoint, narratives on in-group strengthening may be further reinforced by such memories and narratives. Finally, viewpoint one emphasizes acknowledgement, justice, and reparation. This is also consistent with the previous findings from South Korea, which allow the perceived importance of preserving memories and supporting survivors were associated with willingness to participate in collective action, demanding apology and reparation. Moreover, existing theories suggest that victims seek acknowledgement and reparation from the perpetrators as they empower the victim groups. All these points discussed so far illustrate how the components in each in these perspectives are conceptually interrelated and how they form a coherent structure of narratives of collective victim beliefs. Next, let's look at the second factor, which was about inclusivity, pro-social lessons, and moving forward. The most prominent perspective in this factor was consideration of other victims who suffer similarly to or more severely than Korean people did. This included victims and survivors within Korean society, other people and countries around the world, and Korean people in the past. Factor two also rejected the exclusiveness of Korean victimhood and refused the competition, but rather endorsed inclusiveness. Also, the second factor included many pro-social collective victim beliefs, never to be another perpetrator, helping other oppressed groups, acknowledging instances of violence committed by the Koreans were among those. And this perspective was rejected the idea that Koreans should not trust other groups and they can do whatever necessary to defend themselves. The participants also agreed that they should move on because Korean people are no longer under threat and they are doing much better now than they did in the past. But at the same time, they also acknowledge the importance of learning their history of suffering and passing on memory. Thus, the moving on can be understood as not as forgetting the past, but rather moving forward with a more optimistic prospect for the future. And related to the narrative of moving forward, another interesting aspect of this perspective is this viewpoint had a much less aggressive attitude toward the Japanese. Participants in this factor endorsed the notion that the Japanese colonization of Korea was a product of time rather than the evil and violent nature of Japanese people, so they rejected the essentialist arguments. They also agreed that there is a lack of justice, but this statement was endorsed to a much lesser degree than the first viewpoint. Also, the entitlement towards the reparation was somewhat rejected, while the same statement was endorsed in the first viewpoint. So in sum, viewpoint two was characterized by less focus on in-group, and this perspective rejected the exclusiveness and competition of collective victimhood. Rather, there were more focus on other groups suffering and inclusiveness. According to the previous research, inclusive victim consciousness is associated with pro-social intergroup attitudes and behaviors, which is what we observed here. And this perspective also endorsed moving on. There was no perception of ongoing threat or sustained suffering. But still, the participant endorsed preserving the memories of in-group victimhood, but to a lesser degree compared to the viewpoint one. This may imply that participants in this factor perspective or viewpoint may want a more positive future-oriented relations with Japan and thus were less antagonistic towards the perpetrator group. Again, we can see some conceptual links between the different aspects within this viewpoint. The final part of this study would be about the association between collective victim belief structures and people's approaches to intergroup relations. As this is still a preliminary analysis and there is not enough time, I would not go into much detail. But the initial findings suggest that the participant in factor viewpoint two were more likely than the people in viewpoint one to endorse moving away from the past and focusing on better intergroup relations. And they were marginally more likely to support a more practical approach to Japan, such as economic cooperation. So in conclusion, the collection of studies I presented today are a few of the first empirical investigations into diverse set of collective victim beliefs within an understudy context of South Korea. Most of the existing studies explore a small set of collective victim beliefs, but we explore extremely diverse array of collective victim beliefs and look into their structures within South Korea. And such distinct narratives were associated with different approaches to address Japan-South Korea relations. So in conclusion, we argue that our findings have a strong implications on intergroup relations and political discussions within Korea. That's the end of my presentation. Thank you so much for listening. And I will open the floors for questions and discussions. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Yeah, very, very interesting talk. Let me stop the recording.